I will introduce the idea of inflation, and then we'll consider homogeneous isotropic universe and how to describe it, and present different models for inflation, or better to say, scenarios. Now, how one could naturally come to the idea of inflation? Most natural way to come to this idea is to address the question of initial conditions. So, we know the present state of our universe, right? We know that it's expanding, first of all, and second thing which we know, that the matter is distributed today, extremely homogeneously and isotropically on the scales larger than 200 megaparsecs. And when the universe was 1,000 times smaller, then it was distributed everywhere, extremely homogeneously and isotropically, with this kind of accuracy, you see? So, in homogeneity, in the energy density distribution, at the moment of recombination, we are not larger than 10 minus 5. Now, the question is how to prepare the initial state which would lead to the observable state of the universe. What does it mean to prepare initial state? If, for instance, you would have task to create our universe at some initial moment of time, about which question you would need to think first of all. Okay, so you got in your hand some matter distribution, and then you have, first of all, take and distribute this matter somehow in the space, right? It's first thing. One set of initial conditions is initial matter distribution. Then after matter distributed, what is the next task about which you have to think? Goes about initial field of the velocity. So every matter element, to every matter element should be given some initial velocity. And it's completely independent set of initial conditions. Should you take care about accelerations? No, because accelerations will be determined after that by the second Newton law. Yeah? Mass multiplied by the acceleration is given by the, is equal to the gravitational force. Okay, so let's assume that we have these kind of equations, even without assuming general relativity as a particular theory, for which we have to specify as initial condition proper initial matter distribution and also initial field of the velocities. And now, given a state at present moment of time, t is approximately 10^17 seconds, yeah, we want to retranslate this state to some initial moment of time when we have to give this initial condition. Are there any suggestions to take any moment of time as this initial moment of time? T equals zero is not very good. You know why? Because actually at this moment everything is singular. So let's take as initial moment of time the earliest possible time when we can still trust till a certain extent in our notion of space and time. So it's a Planckian moment of time. We know that perhaps at the times which are smaller than these things, non-perturbative quantum gravity should be important, the metric fluctuation should be of the order of one, and therefore we cannot speak about the ground. So now, what we have today? Today we have this big region. So first question which I want to address, what was so special about initial matter distribution? So today we have region CT0, okay, 1028 centimeters, where everything is distributed homogeneously and isotropically. Now, how this page of the universe looked at initial moment of time? Clearly, because universe was expanding at initial moment of time, this page of the universe was smaller. And it was smaller by the ratio of initial scale factor to the current value of the scale factor. So, at initial moment of time, the size of this region was CT0 multiplied by initial value of scale factor to the current value of the scale factor. So, the whole our universe, which we see today, originated from this one region. Now, is this region large or not large? How could we answer this question? We have to compare the size of this region with a typical scale at this moment of time, which characterize the physical processes. So what is the typical scale which characterize the physical processes at this initial moment of time? Of course, it's the size of causally connected region. Let's take it like this one, yeah? L causal. And what is this? It's, of course, speed of light multiplied by the available cosmological time, EI. So now let's compare the size of the patch of the space from the current observable universe originated with the size of causally connected region at this initial moment of time. So what we will do for that? Let's divide these two numbers. Li divided by L causal will be equal to Ct0 divided by Cti, and here Ai divided by A0. So Cc goes away, T0 is 1017, this thing is 10 minus 43, yeah? Second, then, what is the ratio of scale factor? We know the temperature of background radiation is scaling in inverse proportion to the scale factor, right? So temperature is 1 divided by A. Now, clearly that at initial moment of time, when radiation was dominated, temperature at Planckian moment of time of the radiation was about Planckian temperature. Therefore, the ratio of initial scale factor to the current value of scale factor is given by the current temperature of background radiation to the Planckian temperature. Current temperature of background radiation is 3 degrees Kelvin. Planckian temperature is 1019 GV, or in degrees, how much is it? Who knows? 1032. Yeah? Therefore, this ratio is about 10 minus 32. Okay, forget about 3. Here, with these numbers, and therefore, here 1060 multiplied by 10 minus 32, we are getting for this thing 1084. So it means, not 1084, sorry, 1028, yeah? So the size of the patch from the observable universe to the originated was by 28 orders of magnitude larger than the size of the causal region at this initial moment of time. It means, on the other side, if we will assume that gravity doesn't dissolve in homogeneities, it means that in this region, which was consisting out of 1084, 84 is 1029 cubed, yeah? Causally connected subregions, the matter was distributed extremely homogeneously and isotropically. So 1084 is big number or not very big? Of course, it's very big number because, for instance, the number of atoms in our universe is 1080. So you could imagine what you needed to do to prepare this kind of distribution of the matter. And of course, this region from which universe originated was not causally connected from the very beginning. Moreover, we could readdress the same question at any initial moment of time, which is even later than this Planckian moment of time, and we will get that this ratio is always larger than 1. How could we see it in a simple way? Let me reformulate this formula, or you write it, in a little bit different way. So what is AI divided by TI for the order of magnitude estimates? It's derivative, yeah? Of the scale factor. Because if you will take any Pavlov function, then the derivative is as A divided by T up to numerical coefficient of the order of 1. And of course, numerical coefficient of the order of 1 is an essential thing when we speak about so big numbers. Therefore, here you have A dot at initial moment of time, and here A0 divided by T0 will give you A dot at current moment of time. And therefore, Li divided by L causal can be rewritten as A initial dot divided by A zero dot. So you see, this ratio is equal to the ratio of initial speed of the expansion of the whole universe to the current speed of its expansion. Now, you know that gravity in normal condition is always attractive force, right? Therefore, gravity just tries to decelerate your expansion. It means that initial velocity should be always larger than the current speed of the expansion, because gravity just decelerates the expansion. And it means that this ratio in accelerating universe is always larger than one in the past. This is the problem of horizon, you could say like this one. So they are equivalent. So you see that you have to prepare homogeneous isentropic piece of the universe at some initial moment of time in the scales which are always larger than the causally connected region. And you know that the physical processes could not be responsible for this kind of things, because physical processes could propagate things only on the scales of the order of the causal region. Therefore, you have to think that if you are preparing universe, yeah, that you can overcome all these kind of physical laws and could do this thing. So this problem was known for a very long time as a problem of initial condition, of homogeneity, isotropy, and also horizon problem. I told you that all these names go all together. Very clear. Now, but after you prepared, but let's assume that you were so careful, I don't know what you did, but you prepared initial distribution, okay, with this unbelievable accuracy of homogeneity in 1084 causally disconnected region. Then what is your next task? Next task, you have to give initial velocities to the every meta element. And you have to be very careful with this initial velocities, because if you will be uncareful, okay, and send particle in a random way, then you will immediately spoil your original job. Because you will, after that, at the next moment of time, universe will become inhomogeneous in the endanisotropic. Correct? Correct. Therefore, you have as a next task to prepare these initial velocities in 1084 causally disconnected region, yeah, in accordance with the Hubble law. So, in this big uncausal region, you have to arrange for the velocities Hubble law. So, it aggravates the problem of initial matter distribution even more. But let's assume that you did even this kind of task. The next thing, you see, when you write Hubble law, okay, you have to fix here the Hubble constant, initial Hubble constant. So you have to fix Hubble velocities for the given meta distribution. The question is, with which accuracy you have to fix these initial Hubble velocities given the energy density in the universe? To answer this question and to come to the problem of initial velocities for flatness problem, it will be the same thing, yeah? Let's consider big region of gravitating matter today. Let's take kinetic energy of this, kinetic energy of the Hubble expansion of the matter in this region, potential energy of gravitational self-interaction in this region. Let's retranslate this region to some initial moment of time and ask the question, what was the ratio of, at initial moment of time, of the total initial potential kinetic of the total energy for this matter element to just kinetic energy? Kinetic energy at initial moment of time. Let's address this question. You know that, of course, total energy is conserved. Therefore, this sum above you could write as sum of kinetic energy today plus potential energy today divided by what? What happens with kinetic energy? Kinetic energy is proportional to the velocity squared. Therefore, kinetic energy at initial moment of time can be written as kinetic energy today multiplied by the ratio of initial value to the current value of the derivative of scale factor squared. Correct? You could think about these formulas like velocity squared, yeah, in general relativity. You know why? Because this kind of Hubble expansion refers even to infinitely small region. And in infinitely small region, as a precise limit of general relativity, we have non-relativistic mechanics and we have non-relativistic Newtonian theory. So therefore, you are getting these kind of things. Yeah, A zero dot divided by A I dot squared. What do we have for this ratio from observations? It's not zero. It's not much larger than one from observation. This ratio today is of the order of one. Now, the ratio of initial velocity to the current velocity, or inverse ratio, we found already. So it was 10, 20, 80. Okay, initial velocity was larger than the current speed of the expansion by 28 orders of magnitude. So this thing is 10 minus 28. So squared, it will be 10 minus 56. You see? So what does it mean, this thing? It means that negative energy of gravitational self-interaction was compensated positive energy of the Hubble expansion with this unbelievable accuracy, 10 minus 56. And it means also that if for a given matter distribution, you would arrange Hubble expansion, but would make in initial Hubble velocities mistake 10 minus 54%, then you would fail immediately. Either the universe would recollapse during Planckian time, or it would become empty. You see? So it aggravates further the problem of initial condition. So one, two, three already, you know, horrible conditions, right? If you would take like this one. Now, let's go even further. Universe, of course, is homogeneous and isotropic today. But you know that if it would be perfectly homogeneous and isotropic, then there would be no galaxies, there would be no people who would ask questions about initial conditions. And to explain the origin of the structure, after you did all these kind of tasks, okay, so you arranged homogeneous distribution, you arranged initial Hubble velocities, and then to explain structure, you would need also to impose here, on the top of this homogeneous distribution of the energy density, small inhomogeneities with the amplitude delta t, delta epsilon over epsilon at the level of 10 minus 5, and also this particular spectra. Can you imagine how difficult to do it? It's even more difficult than all these first three tasks. So, how to live with this problem? By the way, also, why this problem is called not only initial velocity problem, but also flatness problem. You see, I can explain, sorry for this interruption, because I forgot. It's easy to explain because this kind of compensation of potential and kinetic energy are closely related with the value of the Hubble parameter. Take, for instance, this, how it's called, Friedman equation is equal 8p g over 3 epsilon. Then what we will do? Let's divide both sides on h squared. So here we will write h squared. Here will remain 1. Here, if we will divide by h squared, what we will get? 3h squared divided by 8pg is absolutely critical, right? This kind of combination is 1 divided by epsilon critical. So this right-hand side will be equal epsilon after that divided by epsilon critical, or it's the value of cosmological parameter at appropriate moment of time t. So this one we will take here. This thing, what is this? H squared multiplied by A squared. H squared is A dot divided by A. Therefore, this thing is nothing more than just 1, okay, divided by A dot squared. And from here, it follows that omega at t initial minus 1 is equal A 0 dot divided by AI dot squared. Omega 0 is the value of cosmological parameter today minus 1. Of course, if k is not equal to 0, but if k is equal to 0, then everything is flat. So you see, this ratio is 10 minus 56. Current value of the cosmological parameter is of the order of 1. Therefore, initial value or deviation of initial value of cosmological parameter from omega equal 1 should be at the level of 10 minus 56. And you know that deviation omega from n equal from 1 characterizes how different universe from the flat case. Because flat case corresponds to omega equal 1. Okay, so this explains you why initial condition and flatness problem are in fact synonymous for the same thing. Now, but after we realized how initial should be conditions in decelerated universe, if we want to prepare or if we want to make what we see today, we have to think how to resolve this problem. And of course, people were thinking about the resolution, as you see in a minute. Extremely simple. Why they didn't come to this resolution? I have no idea. Okay, it's psychology. But the only resolution before, for instance, this resolution with inflation came was resolution of this problem with the help of so-called atrophic principle. And people were saying that if universe was not like this one, then there would be no people and nobody would address this question. But even in this case, it was semi-truth and semi-lie, because universe could be a little bit more anisotropic, people would be there. Then, what people were thinking else? People were thinking that we have the current state of the universe. Then what we have to do? One of the topics was to try to reproduce the initial spectra of the perturbations which would give us today the observable structure of the universe. A lot of people were writing thousands of papers about it. You see, so it was not physics up to a certain extent. It was cosmic archaeology. So you were taking the data today, and then you are running program back. Of course, people were thinking what could be the origin of this thing, but nothing was coming in mind. Now, but let's look, to answer all these questions about initial conditions, let's look where is the problem, where problem arises. And of course, you see that problem in this, in both, in all three cases, arise in this kind of ratio. In small value of A0 dot, to A initial dot ratio. It's much smaller than 1. And 1 is much smaller than 1. Why initial velocity is much larger than 1? Because gravity is attractive force. Correct? And for instance, if you would have situation that initially universe was starting not from Big Bang with infinite velocities, but with very small velocities, yeah? Then, of course, there would be no this problem. So what was the standard picture of the evolution of our universe? Here is the speed of expansion, here is the time. So you are beginning with incredible initial velocities, and in the limit t goes to zero, even infinite velocities. And of course, it was one of the questions about which journalists were writing Big Bang, yeah? And then what gravity was doing for you, it was slowing down expansion. And of course, the current speed of the expansion in this picture is always smaller, or even much smaller than the initial speed of the expansion. And what you want to do, you want to arrange or to start somewhere here. Okay, let's take Planckian region away. We don't know what's there, but you want to start somewhere here. You can, in principle, start somewhere here, but finally you have to come to standard Friedman decelerated expansion, yeah? So, what could be your evolution in this case? Of course, in this case, everything is clear. You have to begin somewhere here. Then you have to increase your initial speed of the expansion till such sufficient value, then make transition and then get standard Friedman expansion. So, and what is the basic idea of inflation? The basic idea of inflation is that in the past, there was a stage of accelerated expansion of our universe when gravity was acting as anti-gravity, but you have to add here this graceful exit to Friedman decelerated expansion. So, why I add this graceful exit to Friedman accelerated expansion? Because under inflation, I understand successful scenario when you could smoothly get Friedman universe. Because otherwise, this definition of the inflation would be satisfied also by so-called pre-Big Bang cosmology. But in pre-Big Bang cosmology, there is no graceful exit to Friedman universe. You see? And this is the difference with inflation. So you see, in such a picture, inflation, we have a initial point is smaller or equal a zero point. What does it mean, this thing? First of all, it means that we can produce the whole observable universe from one causally connected region. Look at this ratio here. Yeah? It becomes smaller than one. Second thing, it means also that here initial cosmological parameter could be any value, 2, 3, 5, whatever you want. And it means that also in initial velocities you could make error of the order of 100%, and then the stage of accelerated expansion will correct you this error. You see, because here you begin with small initial velocities, multiply this thing, and then you will get for today approximately omega 0 is equal 1. Approximately. So, then third thing about initial conditions for cosmological perturbations, yeah, for small and homogeneity, is more complicated, more sophisticated question. Therefore, today I will not address you this question, but you will see answer, maybe not tomorrow, but in a week, yeah, to this question. Today I want to concentrate on the most simple features of this kind of model. Okay, considering just homogeneous or inflation in the homogeneous limit. Now, first of all, you understand that in this picture, you do not need to speak anymore about problem of initial conditions for or initial large initial velocities. You don't need to speak about Big Bang. So you would tell journalists that Big Bang, okay, is here. There was no Big Bang. In fact, at the beginning, universe was at rest. And after that, gravity took care about giving these large initial velocities, yeah, to the matter distribution. Now, second thing, you could ask, but should I prepare really extremely homogeneous and isotropic universe everywhere if there is this stage of expansion? Yeah? Or maybe actually you could think that maybe actually I could prepare homogeneous isotropic distribution in this region. Yeah? And then I have inhomogeneities here, and this inhomogeneities will spoil me evolution. Or I have to prepare closed universe, you could think about it. And you see, the answer to this question becomes extremely positive also when it goes about the degree of inhomogeneity at initial moment of time. And this positive answer is related with the fact that In accelerated universe, there always exists event horizon which prevents you, even during infinite expansion, from influence of faraway region. While in accelerated universe, there always exists event horizon, even if universe is expanded infinitely long. I recall your definition of event horizon, what it was. Event horizon, the moment of time t, was equal to the scale factor at the moment of time t, multiplied by conformal distance, which light can propagate beginning from the moment of time t till infinite part, future. Yeah, so it means that this is a maximal distance which light could propagate irrespectively how long, for how long universe exists, would exist in future. So here was t, t maximum, dt over a. And last time I showed you that even if t maximum is infinite, sometimes this integral is convergent. So when it's convergent, let's see. Okay, let's write dt. What is dt? Dt is dA, scale factor derivative, divided by a dot. A dot is derivative with respect to time. Therefore, this integral can be rewritten in the following form. It's from a scale factor to a maximum, and then here you have dA divided by a dot a. Now, a maximum, let's take to be equal infinity, like when universe expands forever. When this integral is convergent, when a dot would be constant, then of course it would be logarithmic divergence. And this integral is convergent only in the case when a dot is growing with a. What does it mean that a dot is growing with a? It means that the speed of the expansion grows as universe expands. So it means accelerated expansion. And in this case, when you have accelerated expansion, yeah, this integral is finite, and it means that there is the region of the influence of the other events by the events in the center of this region. So, therefore, if I would take, for instance, meta distribution, and distribute this meta homogeneously and isotropically in the scales, which are two event horizon scales at this moment of time, and here I will take extremely inhomogeneous distribution, what would happen? The influence of these inhomogeneities doesn't matter how far away, okay, in the future we consider this thing, could be propagated only here, until this border. You understand? The things inside this subregion with the size of event horizon could be influenced only by events here, the initial moment of time, where matter is distributed homogeneously anyway. Therefore, irrespectively, what we have outside this homogeneous region, the homogeneity inside these scales will never be spoiled. And this region will survive as homogeneous region and will be stretched by the expansion, remaining homogeneous, yeah? And all the homogeneities will be here, but final size of this region will be equal by initial size, so the size of event horizon, the initial moment of time, multiplied by the ratio of scale factor at the end of this accelerated expansion, because we have to finish it, to the value of scale factor at the initial moment of time. So you understand that in homogeneous universe, you have to find some region which is homogeneous enough, and then you could stretch it to any scale to which you want. Now, is this kind of accelerated expansion causal or uncausal? Because some people speak some kind of clutch when they say about inflation, they say it's superluminal, it's a causal, etc., etc., etc. Of course, it's causal, as you understand, because in general relativity, everything is causal. And to understand why it's causal, just let's take this region, consider its expansion, and calculates the size of the particle horizon. Not of event horizon, size of particle horizon characterizes you the scale of causal region. And what is the particle horizon in the case of accelerated expansion? So in the case of accelerated expansion, the size of particle horizon, P, at the moment of time t, could be written. So let me do the same calculation, substitute instead of dt here, dA over A dot. So I will write immediately integral like this one, AT, then integral dA divided by A dot A. But right now I have to integrate from the initial value of scale factor till the current value of scale factor in which, at the moment in which I am interested, how large is the scale of particle horizon. So it means the scale over which line propagated between time t and initial moment of time ti when particle horizon was like this here. Now, when we have accelerated expansion, right, then from which region to this integral, which region gives the maximum contribution? Of course, the region where integrand takes the maximum value. And when integrand takes the maximum value at initial moment of time, because after that, this integral is decreasing in accelerated universe. And now, if I will multiply, so this A should be large enough, and then it could be even infinite, but nevertheless, the integral will be the same, as you understand, yeah? Because the maximum contribution comes from AR. So if it's infinite, then this integral is the size of event horizon, yeah, at initial moment of time, no, up to the scale factor. So multiplied by AI divided by AI. So this is event horizon, and this is the ratio of scale factor. So particle horizon at the moment of time t is given by the ratio of scale factor at the moment of time t to initial value of scale factor multiplied by the size of event horizon, roughly speaking, at initial moment of time. So you understand that the size of the particle horizon in the case of this expansion is equal to the size of the universe. So everything is causal. And you should never confuse the region of causality with the size of the event horizon. And you understand, there is actually also a very important thing, that in accelerated universe, the curvature scale, which is inverse Hubble scale, is equal to the size of event horizon. In decelerated universe, it's often of the same order of magnitude as the size of particle horizon. You see, therefore, when people say horizon, 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 they have to keep in mind which horizon. What is important for the evolution of perturbation, cosmological perturbation, as we will see, in fact, the curvature scale, not this kind of kinematical things like event horizon, particle horizon, etc. Therefore, when people were speaking, for instance, that perturbation, right, that was one of the confusions. People were telling that perturbation, inflationary universe are taken beyond the horizon. But they will take it beyond the event horizon, which has nothing to do with causality, you see? And in fact, they were frozen when they were taken beyond the event horizon. But why they were frozen? Because curvature scale was important. Curvature scale in accelerated universe is of the order of event horizon, but not particle horizon, in distinction from our decelerated universe. Now, but of course, you could say, but why should I prepare homogeneous isotropic region with the accuracy 10 minus 5, it's headache, yeah? Even within one causally connected region. Perhaps some physics could be responsible for it. I don't know any physics, nobody knows any physics, which would be responsible for it. But I am extremely lazy, and instead of preparing homogeneous isotropic distribution within one causally connected region, I still address the question, okay? So you could use either your head or your hand, as you understand, right? And using hands sometimes is not as efficient as using head. So you would address question, but what would happen if I would be so uncareful that I just will prepare, okay, distribution within one causally connected region, CTI, okay, where delta epsilon over epsilon is of the order of 1. It's maximum what can I do, you could say. So in this case, could I resolve the problem of initial conditions or not? And you see, happily, you will find that even in this case, you can solve the problem of initial condition. If you will not so much care about initial distribution, okay, with extremely high accuracy, even in one causally connected region. Why? Because the stage of accelerated expansion has another nice property. It has no classical hairs. What does it mean, this thing? This thing means that when you will be stretching this region and universe will undergo the stage of accelerated expansion, the new inhomogeneities will not appear here, will not be generated here. Just these old inhomogeneities will be stretched on much, much larger scales. And the degree of homogeneity within one causally connected region, yeah, will be increasing, increasing, and increasing. Because finally, okay, you could take here small subregion, stretch it on the scale of the order of causally connected, not causally connected region, on the scale of the order of the inverse Hubble, scale of the horizon. And then, of course, you understand that from this quasi homogeneous thing, okay, not a lot of things will come here. Also, you understand that if you will take big mountain, okay, it will be without increasing height, okay, increasing just its base, and what finally in the limit you would get, of course you would get plate, or how it's called in Argentina, yeah?
Plateau.
Plateau, yeah, you will get plateau. Here is the same situation. But of course, on the way, when you will be doing this thing, volcano should not, or volcano, should not function. So, no volcano means no hair. Theory, classical no hair, classical no hair theory. But if you want to do this kind of job, inflation, then, of course, you want, what you want to do? You want to explain the origin of the whole universe from some very, very small sub-region of causally connected region, yeah? And what kind of condition in this case you have to satisfy? You have to satisfy condition that initial speed of the expansion should be not smaller than the current speed of the expansion, but it should be much smaller than the current speed of the expansion. In this case, you understand that the range actually is given by this ratio. In this case, you would have initial inhomogeneities of the order of 1, anyway, they would be smoothed out by expansion. And what does it mean? By the way, if you have the things of the order of 1 within causally connected region, then this speed of the expansion should be 5 orders of magnitude smaller than the current speed of the expansion. You see? Okay, the estimate I will not do because I have limited time. But it's in the book anyway. Now, but what does it mean, this statement? This statement means some kind of nice thing. It means one of the first and most important, no, not most important, and important prediction of inflation. In fact, take this formula, omega ti minus 1, omega 0 minus 1, and rewrite it in a little bit different form, and rewrite it in the following form. Omega I, initial value, not omega I, omega 0, yeah, current value of cosmological parameter should be equal 1, okay, so 1 I take from the other side, plus omega I minus 1 multiplied by a initial dot over a zero dot squared. If A zero dot square over A initial dot over A zero dot is much, much smaller than 1, by 5 orders of magnitude, yeah, as I said, then if omega initial is of the order of 1, 2, 3, 5, whatever you want, half, how large is this term? It's 10 minus 10. Yeah? So you can forget about it. And what you are getting is that with accuracy 10 minus 10, omega 0 today should be equal 1. You see? In fact, because of quantum fluctuations, here deviation, as you will see, omega from n from omega equal 1 will be of the order of 10 minus 5, not 10 minus 10. This is prediction. If inflation was even longer, I mean, if A0 was 10 minus 10 from omega from smaller than A0 dot, yeah, then it's even better. So you see, there is upper, lower bound on the duration of inflation, but there is no upper bound in this sense. You see, you just produce much larger than the observed region if inflation was lasting much longer. But you know that this prediction is extremely robust, and of course it's not based on any inflationary model. It's just based on very, very simple argument at the level of primary school. Now, you could ask, up to what extent this prediction is trivial or non-trivial? Of course, today people will say that it's trivial. But even 5 years ago or 10 years ago, it was extremely non-trivial. And if in 1980 you would tell astronomers that omega is equal 1 and our universe is flat, they would think that you have to go to doctor and check, okay, your psychological health. Because at this time, of course, everybody was convinced that omega is smaller than 1. Okay, for most of the astronomers, omega was 0.05. Omega 0 was 0.05. It's what you see in baryons normally. 6, they could write here, 7. Some astronomers, which were not so conservative, okay, and one of the first one, not conservative astronomers, was Zwicky, could speak about dark matter because there was problem with the Birial theorem. For instance, when you apply it to the clusters of galaxies, you needed to assume that the cluster is not virialized, God knows what. Some people were introducing all kind of, I don't know how to characterize it more in a smooth way, yeah? But okay, I will not characterize it, but some theories like Mond, yeah? Modification of Newtonian gravity because of this kind of dynamics. But you know that even those astronomers who have a lot of courage could never come to the number larger than 0.2, 0.3. Because of the, because it follows from this virial dynamics. And of course, everybody was convinced that the universe is open. And I remember that when we were in 80 was giving talk in Moscow somewhere, and he was discussing closed universe. I said, what kind of guy is this? What kind of things he is discussing? Because, of course, for astronomers, it would sound a little bit specific. Special. But now, this number, by the way, which follows from Virial theorem, as I told you already, was confirmed as a result of many further observations. Even in 95, from the Virial theorem, people could never get more than 20-30% in dark matter, okay, which is located in the halos of galaxies, as you understand. And situation, from astronomical point of view, was so bad that some people started to write questions or papers about open inflation. And what was the basic idea of open inflation? Of course, I don't want to go to the idea, but you understand that this is a robust prediction. What you have to do? You have to spoil this robust prediction. So how people were spoiling it? In a very interesting way. So they were taking so-called two inflationary model. First inflation was giving you this prediction. After that, they were making potentials like this one with tunneling for the second inflation. And when you have tunneling through the potential, the bubble is formed. And bubble, in fact, synchronizes your hypersurfaces of time of t equal constant, of energy equal constant. Okay, for those people who know, okay, this is solution which is so-called Coleman Deluche solution, which corresponds to the open universe. And then, of course, if you would inflate even open universe for long enough time, it will become increasingly flat. So to get number 0.2, you needed to arrange the duration of second inflationary stage to be precisely, okay, 53 inverse Hubble time. Of course, it's not even theory, God knows what, very complicated model just to fit one number. And of course, when we were discussing things with Andrei, I was telling Andrei, okay, be quiet, okay, I know what does it mean, all this astronomical data, let's wait and everything will come right. As I think came right, in fact, in 1999, as you know, and of course, first excitement about this thing was when people measured supernova, about which I talked last time, at large distances, and they discovered that to explain this data about supernova, you need dark energy, homogeneous, smooth component in the universe. And when people discovered second Doppler peaks, of course, second Doppler peak, of course, I didn't realize that this time, that the discovery of second Doppler peak inevitably means also, in the fluctuation of background radiation, inevitably means the existence of this dark energy component. This I will explain later why it's so. But you understand that how could you realize it this time actually? Because you could fit, of course, data with certain things, but how people were fitting this data? They were taking computer code with 6 parameter or even more, and they were writing this computer code and then getting all these kind of curves, you see. And after I actually did my CMB slower, I realized that actually the location, not just location, but the existence of second order peak is extremely sensitive with respect to the presence of this dark energy component. So without dark energy, you cannot understand this thing. You see, if there would be only supernova data, I would dance this thing. Because with supernova, you understand, there is a lot of systematics, as I said. There is dust, etc. But when it comes together with CMB fluctuation data, which are not astrophysical, as usually I say, but physical data. You know what is the difference between physical and astrophysical data? In physical data, or in physics, systematics is under control, under relative control. In astrophysical data, systematics is not under control, practically never. So you never know actually what is there. Of course, situation is improving, but not as fast as in physics. You see, cosmology became real physics with CMB data, mostly. And unfortunately, perhaps CMB will remain the only so-called source of physical data set. Because I was discussing this thing, you know, that, okay, I will tell you a joke. It's not a joke, in fact. I had actually a discussion with some big boss in astrophysics, real big boss. They have real big bosses there. And I told that, of course, in astrophysics, you need big bosses more than in physics. Because in physics, the largest boss is experiments. And after that, doesn't matter who are you and where are you. Princeton or something, okay, you can forget about your reputation. But in astrophysics, you need bosses. Why? Because there is too much systematics, and somebody should tell how to reduce the systematics. But now I told the time is changing. Because CMB data is coming, and it becomes real physics. But one of the other guys who was sitting there was big expert in line on Alpha Flores told that perhaps CMB will remain at least for the next 50 years still the only source of real physical data. You see in cosmology. Who knows? But you see, it's really okay, great things, and also supernova, in spite of the fact that it's more dirty things, it's also great. Now, before we will go, okay, before I make break, I want to address question in general terms how gravity can be recalcit and how it would lead to this stage of accelerated expansion of our universe. In general terms, I already discussed this thing, but you know that actually when I repeat the same things, then I think, okay, it's no big damage. So how gravity can become repulsive? Because you could, of course, raise natural equation, why people came to idea of inflation in 1980s, but not before, because what I told you sounds like triviality, yeah? So one of the things which you could think perhaps, okay, nobody could imagine that gravity can become repulsive, yeah? But it's also wrong. Gravity become repulsive, and in fact, as I told you already De Sitter got gravity as a repulsive force in 1917, before Friedman universe. And I don't remember, did I tell you a story about this guy called Bepson? No? You know that in Boston area, it's beginning of last century, lived some guy, Bepson, I don't know who knows, anybody knows his name or not. People who actually work on gravity should know his name because he left money for the price for these short issues in gravity, yeah? So this guy believed in general relativity as in universal theory. So he believed that it describes the American economy. And he predicted economical crisis in 1930 based on Einstein equations. I'm not kidding, because he made a lot of money, you see? But after that, he started to believe also, he was unhappy that airplane sometimes unpredictably fall down, because at this time the number of accidents was even more. Therefore, he thought that the next big step, okay, which people should do in gravity, they have to create some kind of anti-gravity. And he left money for research in anti-gravity with conditions that this money will be used not earlier than in 50 years. So it's not a lot of money, but nevertheless, it's some money. And in 1980, okay, together with inflation, this money came in work also. Because on this money, Alex Vilenkin founded his Institute of Cosmology. And this money, perhaps I enough only for a couple of postdocs or even less. So you know that there are not too many people who should work in anti-gravity. But you understand, actually, intuition of this guy works second time in a perfect way. The most amazing thing. So, how gravity can become repulsive? Let's write Friedman equation for acceleration. Okay, it's 4pg divided by 3 epsilon plus 3p multiplied by a. Of course, if there would be just Newtonian theory, you could understand that gravity could become repulsive only in the case when there is negative energy which nobody has seen. But in general relativity, to have gravity as anti-gravity, okay, this combination of epsilon plus 3 pressure should just become negative. Normally it's positive, and when it's positive, people call it energy dominance condition. And by the way, you should keep in mind that all theorems, because of which Hawking became famous, theorems of singularities, about unavoidance of singularities, were proved under condition that epsilon plus 3p is positive. So all these theorems do not go when energy dominance condition is violated. Therefore, you see, there is actually a good way to avoid singularities when you break energy dominance condition. How to do it constructively, nobody knows until now. But I think it's one of the good problems which could be addressed. Now, so gravity, when this combination is negative, then instead of minus here, we have plus, and acceleration becomes positive if epsilon plus 3p is negative. So you see, you could now give the following definition of inflation. that inflation is the stage of accelerated expansion when gravity is acting as anti-gravity and the energy, strong energy dominance condition is violated. Now, what kind of matter we have seen for which energy dominance condition is violated? One of the examples I already gave to you, it was the example of the cosmological constant, which in terms of pressure and energy density has equation of state pressure is equal minus energy density. In this case, epsilon plus 3p is equal minus 2 energy density. So you see, if energy density here is positive, then cosmological constant, positive cosmological constant, acts like anti-gravity agent, yeah? And leads to accelerated expansion. And also we found that in this case, universe is expanding in asymptotically, at least, okay, in all three cases, exponentially, so scale factor is proportional exponent h lambda, where h lambda is constant, real constant, not just, okay, time independent, multiplied by time. Yeah? And of course, in this case, a dot is proportional to a. So, acceleration grows linearly with the scale factor here. So it could be perfect, so-called candidate for inflation, but in fact it's not perfect candidate for inflation. Why? Because constant is always constant and nothing happens with it. And if there would be stage of inflation with cosmological constants, then we would see this inflation even today. Since in the case of cosmological constant, you do not have graceful exit to Friedman universe, so this inflation is completely useless. Moreover, if you want to have graceful exit from inflation to Friedman universe, you have to have with necessity deviation from cosmological constant. And you have to break time translational invariance. Otherwise, if there would be time translational invariance, the things would go forever. Then, yeah.
But we have inflation today, right?
No, today. But we know that, okay, a billion years ago, we were not on inflation. You see, because if you would be always on inflation, you would not be here. It would be just empty, the Sitter universe, as you understand, but we formed all these galaxies, etc. And today also, it's only 70% of the whole things, yeah? So, today is not completely inflation. Today, by the way, cosmological constant could be responsible for this acceleration. Who cares? After that, you don't need to have graceful exit to anything, as you understand. Now, The other things, which is extremely important, of course, which role plays the symmetry of De Sitter space? For instance, holographic principle, okay, for De Sitter, etc., for cosmology. I think from my previous, what I said previously, okay, you could conclude that no role at all. Because these kind of problems, okay, these the Sitter state as precise state of the universe, they are not relevant for cosmology, because from the Sitter space, the only thing which we need from cosmology is zero-order approximation for really some small bounded region. You see, physics is local in this case. And you don't need actually to consider all kinds of crazy things, okay, with holography for the Sitter space if you want to use them in inflation. Inflation has nothing to do with the Sitter state. Therefore, first thing which we have to realize is that something should be changing during this the Sitter stage. So, what should be changing? So, let's consider the question duration of inflation. You see, let's take okay, and rewrite second derivative of scale factor over scale factor in terms of Hubble constant and time derivative of Hubble constant. Now, what we have on inflation? On inflation, A2 dot should be positive. And you know, in general, of course, H squared is positive, and H dot is negative, generically. So it's smaller than zero. So when H dot squared is much larger than H dot, H squared is much larger than H dot, you can forget about this term. H is constant, you have positive acceleration. What kind of solution you have in this case? Cos de theta solution. Or solution which is close to de theta, which is deviated from de theta by only this term. Now, in the normal universe, I mean which is decelerating universe, this term is positive, of course. This term is negative. But this negative term is larger than this positive term by the factor of the order of 1. Therefore, the total sum is negative. Correct? Correct. And then A2 dot is negative. So if you have at the beginning A2 dot larger than zero, there, in a certain time, you have to go to the stage of decelerated expansion is A2 dot smaller than zero. What you have to do? You have to change these two terms here somehow. Either you have to increase the absolute value of H dot or decrease the value of H squared. Or this quantity could go down, this quantity, absolute value of this quantity can go up, and then inflation will be over when these two things will be equal to each other. Correct? Correct. So, but the simplest case, of course, is the case where H dot remains practically constant, H dot is negative, then what happens with H? If H dot is negative, H is decreasing. So this term H squared is decreasing, this stays constant. So, on the graph, you have the things like this one. For H dot, you have constant, negative constant H dot, okay, absolute value, and H squared is decreasing linearly, okay? And then at the point where these two things are crossing, inflation is over. In this case, how you could estimate, for instance, the duration of inflation? It's a simple estimate. The simple estimate for time of the duration of inflation is hi, initial value of Hubble constant, divided by hi dot. Agreed. So it's the time during which, through which actually these two things will cross with each other. Then when h dot much smaller than h squared, then as I told you already, H dot much smaller than H squared, then solution is approximately exponential. So it's xi multiplied by t. Correct? Correct. So, and therefore, for the ratio of final scale factor to the initial scale factor during this inflationary stage, what you are getting? You are getting that it's the same thing as AF for exponential expansion dot divided by A initial dot, because velocity is increasing linearly with scale factor. It's equal exponent H initial multiplied by TF. Now, if we want to have successful inflation, remember this kind of okay graph. So what should be the ratio of the derivative of scale factor at the end of the inflation to the current value of scale factor? It should be the same as in the case when I was calculating things in the absence of inflationary stage. So your problem, the problem of inflation, was to increase the ratio of the velocities by 28 orders of magnitude. Yeah? Correct? Correct. Therefore, if you were to have successful inflation, then this ratio should be larger than 1028. And this means also that the duration of inflation, okay, should be larger than 70 h minus a initial minus 5. Why 70? Because he exponent here 10, yeah? So logarithm 10 basis e is 2.3. So this is 2.3 multiplied by 28. Now, if you wanted to have inhomogeneities within causally connected region of the order of 1, then of course you have to have a little bit longer inflation. And in this case, the duration of inflation should be larger than 75 in your Hubble time. But this is, and I want to stress, the low bound on the duration of inflation. If you want to produce the page of the observable universe like we see today, inflation should last not less than 70-75 inverse Hubble time. It could last even forever, but not less than 75 inverse Hubble time. Now we could ask, what does it mean, this kind of restriction, in terms of the equation of state? Okay, so last formula and then we make break. In terms of the equation of state on inflation, it means the following thing. You see, how we characterize, what is the convenient way to characterize equation of state during inflation? You could take this ratio, epsilon plus p divided by epsilon, which is equal zero for cosmological constant. You also understand that if you want to have graceful exit, then this quantity should be different from zero, because cosmological constant will remain constant. Now, if you want to have enough duration for inflation, of course, this quantity epsilon plus p divided by epsilon should not deviate too much from cosmological constant, yeah? Correct? Because it would deviate too much, then everything would be changing. Because, for instance, energy density is proportional to epsilon plus p, yeah, etc. So energy density would be changing, Hubble constant would be changing, deviation would be increasing, etc. Not epsilon, 3h epsilon plus p. So, let's ask question. How large should be this quantity if you want generically to have inflationary stage at least for 70 inverse Hubble time? So epsilon is proportional to the Hubble, it's proportional, is equal 3/8 p Hubble constant squared, right? Then epsilon plus p, as it follows from Einstein equation, is equal minus 4p, 1/4 pi, minus 1/4 pi, h dot. You could derive it from Einstein equation. Therefore, this ratio you could write as 2/3 h I dot divided by h I squared. And this quantity, as you understand from this formula, yeah, so this quantity should be at least or larger than 70 h I, okay, from here, duration of inflation. So for the quantity h dot divided by h squared, you have 170, here 3/2. So you have here 3/2, 1/70. So it's about 10^-2. So if you want generically to have inflation which lasts more than 70 inverse Hubble time, then deviation of equation of state from cosmological constant should not be more than about 1%. And you understand also why. And it could be less. But if it's less, then of course you have to have more and more and more time to deviate more and more and more from cosmological constant. When epsilon plus p over epsilon becomes of the order of 1, you have graceful exit. But what is relevant for you? For you is relevant only this last 70 effort of inflation, which are responsible for the observable today page of the universe. Because previous inflationary stage refers to the scales which are much, much larger than the observable horizon. Yeah.
How did you get estimate for H dot?
For H dot, from here. So, TT, you could write like H divided by H dot, yeah? Then, this thing should be about 70 or larger than 70 inverse Hubble time. And then you are getting H dot divided by H squared, okay? H squared you take here. It's 1 over 70. Yeah.
When you say there's no upper bound on that, well, maybe you could qualify, because at some point you're supposing that there's an homogeneity in the initial condition.
Yeah.
You don't want to suppose an homogeneity, you know, way below Planck's care.
Right.
So if you assume that you don't make any assumption at Planck's care, then it gives you an upper bound.
Of course, there will be in reality, a real concrete model,
Yeah, but even in general,
From above, there should be no bound in principle, because you see everything, what was on the previous stages, for us, relevant for what we see only 70 last defaults. But what was before is stretched on the scales, which are larger than the observable
today. Yeah, the development would come from the fact that you don't want to suppose the homogeneity below Planck's care, where not happens, right? If you assume that you cannot assume that your spectra is completely homogeneous way below Planck's care.
No. I don't want to claim that on the largest scales, or the scales which are larger than the horizon, the thing should be homogeneous.
No, I'm sort of the smaller scale. So if you look at very, very, very initial, you know, there's a restriction. You don't want your.
I know, if you don't want, yes.
You don't want your initial condition to say something about. A regime of physics where you know it's going to be.
Yeah, but you know that actually everything, what was before this last 74, considering of inhomogeneities also, is stretched to the scale which we will never see.
Well, it depends. So, you know, Planck scale will be stretched today, and you can imagine Planck scale being inhomogeneous. It's just that if there's too many folding.
Yeah.
Then it will stretch too much, in the sense that...
Too much is never the problem.
No, too much is in the sense that something which will be below Planck scale initially will be visible now.
Yeah, of course, and there I think...
That you don't...
Yeah, no, no, this I want. Absolutely, this I want. And what you say... what you say right now, it's so-called super Planck problem. Without this thing, I will never survive. For Hawking radiation, of course, you also will never survive. But this is fictitious problem. As I will try to explain you later when I will be discussing perturbation. Because it's a question how our way of describing these things. We could think about it differently a little bit. You see, it's the same fictitious problem as you would be describing Minkowski space in expanded coordinate system. Imagine, something would be happening in Minkowski space, nothing. But nevertheless, in the way how you describe it, you would see that some kind of quantum fluctuations are coming from the Planckian scale. But this is a different thing which we can discuss later. So right now let's make 20 minutes break. Yeah? Okay.